Let us stand together.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due God's name. The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
The God of glory thunders, the Lord over mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is powerful.
The voice of the Lord is full of
majesty. In the beginning, darkness covered the deep, and God said, "Let there be light."
The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
Through the words of the prophet, the Lord said, "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you."
The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
"Do not fear," says the Lord, "I am with you. I have called you by name. You are mine." When Jesus was baptized by John, suddenly the heavens were opened.
The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
And as Jesus was coming out of the water, the Spirit of God rested on him like a dove.
The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
And a voice said, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Almighty God, you anointed Jesus at his baptism with the Holy Spirit and revealed him as your beloved Son. Keep us, your children born of water and the Spirit, faithful in your service, that we may rejoice to be called children of God through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Let us pray. Guide us, O God, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover your peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, a reading from Isaiah. "But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you, I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east and from the west. I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Hear a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. The two went down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for yet the Spirit had not come upon any of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Holy Word, holy wisdom. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As the people were filled with expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now, when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord. Today, Jesus undergoes baptism, John's baptism of repentance. The sinless one takes his place among the declared unclean. Gordon Lathrop says, Jesus undergoes the bath that washes Jesus among the unclean and impure. Though Jesus is baptized, he is never a baptizer. There are hints that Jesus' disciples may have baptized people, but no evidence that Jesus himself ever did. To celebrate this festival of Jesus' baptism, the lectionary takes us to the Jordan River, where we begin every Sunday. For this font right over there, always filled with water, set in motion by virtue of pouring, not only marks the beginning of faith, but is the grace-filled sign of faith's renewal, blessing us each time we cross this threshold into this space. Kathy Johnson had a very nice way of describing what made West Plano special. She said, "It's all about the water. How could it not be about audible, liquid grace?" Baptism marks us as belonging to Christ. Baptism initiates us into the life of grace and service. Baptism transforms personal identity into a plural, where all are gifted, all are needed, none are dispensable or disposable, because God has made each of us necessary to the well-being of the whole. The way in to this unusual anti-Lone Ranger society is death by water, which becomes through the Spirit a birth, a resurrection into a life no way possible by any other means. Kathy Johnson gets it. It is about the water. And Lamott gets it as well. She asks the question in her book, Traveling Mercies, and I'll give it a little bit of her attitude. "Can you imagine how discouraging it was for me to live in fear of weather, of drizzle or downpour? Because Christianity is about water. It's about baptism, for God's sake. It's about falling into something elemental and wet. Most of what we do in worldly life," she writes, "is geared toward our staying dry, looking good, not going under. But in baptism, in lakes and rain and tanks and fonts, you agree to do something that's a little sloppy, because at the same time, it's also holy and absurd. It's about surrender, giving in to all those things we can't control. It's a willingness to let go of balance and decorum and get drenched." I've been asked by Kim Long, the editor of Call to Worship, to write an article for the journal It's due in April. In her email, she says this: I have a couple of ideas in mind. One is an article on baptism as both gift and call. Walking wet, perhaps. She wrote that. I did not prompt that. Well, how do you think I responded? The reason I said yes is because it gives me the opportunity, as retirement approaches, to reflect over my entire professional career. Now, let me ask you something. What have you learned? You. What have you learned about the meaning of baptism and baptismal living that you think other Presbyterians should not miss? If you have any thoughts, please send them my way. Some of you might think that people need to realize just how dangerous baptism is. That to be baptized means we consent to God messing with our lives, rather than living as if baptism gets God to endorse our point of view. Which gets back, I think, to what I said about baptism being a death, then a resurrection. Let me tell you a story. This one by John Westerhoff. Westerhoff once witnessed a baptism in a small church in a Latin American country. The community of faith had gathered, like we have. They recall great God's gracious acts. They proclaim the gospel. And then the congregation began the mournful sounds of a funeral hymn as a solemn procession moved down the aisle. A father carried a child's coffin that he'd made from wood, and the mother carried a bucket of water from the family well. A priest carried their sleeping child, totally naked, except wrapped in a native blanket. As they reached the chancel, the father placed the coffin on the altar, and then the mother poured the water from her bucket from that well into the coffin. And the priest covered the wakening child with embalming fluid. The singing softened to a whisper. The priest slowly lowered the child into the coffin and immersed the child's head with water. And as he did so, this is what he said: I kill you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. To which then the congregation resoundingly said, Amen! And then quickly lifting the child into the air for all to see, he declared, And I resurrect you, that you might love and serve the Lord. Immediately the congregation broke into a glorious Easter hymn, but it was not over. The priest covered the child with the oils of birth. He dressed the child in a beautiful homemade white robe. And then once again the singing quieted softly as the priest anointed the child, making the sign of the cross on the child's forehead, said, I brand you with the sign of Christ, that you and the world will always know who you are and to whom you belong. You don't forget a baptism like that.
whatever else you might say about what was done in this baptism, we might all agree that there was no missing the point. Baptism is a radical dying and rising to a life we cannot make for ourselves, that unites us to a Jesus Christ who calls us to a revolutionary life. I say revolutionary because the life of Jesus and the community of the baptized calls for the defeat of ego tyranny, which we've all seen too much of, which tears at neighborliness, scoffs at justice, and ridicules mercy as weakness. You know, when I was growing up as a Presbyterian, baptism seemed to me just a fuzzy, warm welcome into God's family. I heard nothing about dying and rising. That dimension of baptismal meaning appears to have been forgotten in an era when baptism was just a rite of passage into a predominantly Christian culture. But the idea of death and radical rebirth has deep roots in the life of the church. The Syrian poet Ephraim describes that font, as the second womb. How do you like that? A womb that gives birth without pangs to the children of the kingdom. And the priest, minister, as midwife who ministers to the womb as it gives birth. What Presbyterians are gradually learning to do, and we are, it's happening slowly across the denomination, is tell the truth about baptism, which is exactly telling the truth about following Jesus. And this telling the truth touches not only what we say about baptism, but how we celebrate it. Since the most powerful way we say anything is when our doing something matches our speaking it. Starting tomorrow and continuing through my last Sunday as pastor of this church, every wisdom for a new week will in some way or another be a reflection on baptism. I'm tapping into all my favorite stuff. I hope you take a moment each Monday to reflect on what I provide. Some years ago, Curlin Richter welcomed a newly baptized child, her name Amelia, into the Christian community. And I found what she said, which was recorded or written in a general theological seminary newsletter coming out of Berkeley, California. I found what she said eloquent and truthful. So imagine this seminary student speaking to an infant child newly baptized, addressing her directly, with a congregation listening in. I am sorry, Amelia, but we are bringing you into a family of fools. We're willing to go recklessly into a world that believes in hedging its bets, saving its skin, and being terrified. We are going out that door into a world that does not leap into the arms of death. But Amelia, that is exactly what we will do. Not just today, but over and over and over and over again. Every time we come to this table, we come to dine. We come to die, she said, and we come to live. And it is because of these dark, dangerous waters of baptism that we know with every pulse of our hearts that those are the same thing. Amelia, hear our stories. Die with us. Live with us. Taste and see and sing with us. And what exactly will Amelia experience as she lives out her baptismal journey? Same as for you and me. The promise of God sung by Isaiah in our reading. I love you and you are mine, and I will never let you go. Or in the words of Paul from Romans 8, adapted for our moment in time, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, neither pandemics nor plagues, neither climate change nor political crises, neither menacing terrors or threats not yet imagined will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray. God of bath and banquet, your generosity is without bounds. You birth and bless us, claim and call us to life and love in such fullness that you alone are worthy of praise and devotion. Though shadows still darken this world and tears are not yet dried, it is your presence we seek and your purpose to follow. For the sake of him with whom we have been joined in baptism, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Together in faith, let us confess the faith of our baptism. We believe in one God.
Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In our prayers today, one of the joys to share with you that has been reported from Priscilla to the Mission Justice and Society Ministry team is that our Jeremiah's plot has been awarded a grant from Live Green in Plano of $1,800. It's one of the sustainable community grants. A lot of hard work went into applying for this, and we're grateful, and we look forward to how that will enhance that ministry. In our prayers today, let us remember the family of Terry Johnston, that family faces significant health concerns. Let us remember Emily McHale, who's been diagnosed with COVID and is in the process of recovering. Also, Greg Robinson. As you know, Elizabeth and Samuel were in Puerto Rico. They've now returned safely. They're quarantining. Their family, many of them, became infected with COVID, and they've been trying to get tested. I don't know if they've been able to do so, but they are exercising caution. Let us remember them in our prayers, as well as others we may not be aware of who are suffering from the Omicron variant. Jessica, may I invite you to share your concerns? Thank you. We will remember Brian in our prayers. Betty, your concerns, if you give us an update. Let us remember Nancy Stevens, as well as Susan and Scott in their care for her. Dennis Heyman, I spoke with him this week, is continuing to improve, and it is a great help that he can travel by car to rehab. He's making good progress, and we're grateful for that. Are there other concerns to be shared? Yes. Yes. And I'll share with you that Presbytery is pulling back from in-person gatherings and reassessing all of its ministry activities. In addition, Steve Shive has returned. I think his mother is in Wyoming. In any case, she's in the process of dying, and her condition calls for his presence there. Let us remember him. Steve Shive is our interim executive presbyter. Are there any other concerns to be remembered?
On this Sunday of our Lord's baptism, let us pray for God's mercy throughout this new year, remembering the earth, the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of new life and joy, we pray for the worldwide church and all engaged in its ministry, for all who will be baptized this year, and for kinsmen Charlie, Sophia, Lucy, and Eric, who will reaffirm their baptismal covenant this spring, and for all who serve as sponsors and faith formation ministers, that the Holy Spirit will empower all the faithful for lives of service. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign Creator and Ruler of nations, we pray for the waters of the earth, its seas, lakes, and rivers. We pray for the nations of the world and their leaders in these perilous times. Make successful international efforts to prevent war and reduce violence. Give aid to our government now more deeply in crisis a year after an insurrection. Strengthen all working to stabilize our democracy and rebuild a respect for truth. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Benevolent God, we pray for struggling in this challenging winter season, for communities, colleges, and universities, working to safely educate our children, youth, and young adults, for all afflicted with the coronavirus, for everyone in need of medical attention but unable to receive it, for exhausted healthcare workers, chaplains, and administrators. Remember those who are hungry or homeless, alone and despair. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of compassion, look tenderly on all we have named in this assembly, as well as those we hold in our hearts. And we pray for ourselves, to be gracious to us, O God, tired and needy as we are. Refresh us with strength, courage, and hope, so that we can faithfully serve others as you have called us. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty and most merciful God, you are the mighty voice from heaven. You are our beloved Savior. You are the descending dove. We remember with thanksgiving all who have completed their baptism in death and who dwell in your eternal presence. Inspire us with their memory to show your love to all the world. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us stand together. Siblings in Christ, the peace of Christ be with you. Let us share the sign of Christ's peace with one another. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, choir. Let us stand together at this table. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are all who find refuge in God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 God of power and might, and the earth are full of your glory. He who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Holy God, holy and mighty one, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus your Son. Baptized in Jordan's waters, he took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, to restore sight to the blind, to free the oppressed. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, ascension, we await his coming in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this holy food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, as you once claimed us in the Spirit's waters and number us among your own beloved, give us power to do your work, to show your love, and to live holy and joyful lives. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, we are bold to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Loving God, you graciously feed us who have received these holy mysteries with the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. May we who have received this sacrament be strengthened in your service. We who have sung your praises tell of your glory and truth. We who have seen the greatness of your love see you face to face in your kingdom. For you have made us your own people by the death and resurrection of your Son, our Lord, and by the life-giving power of your Spirit. Amen.
Amen. I will lift you up all your fear.
You will hear my voice,
claim you as my choice.
Be still and know I am here.
A couple of brief announcements. Lectionary study begins again, resumes tomorrow. Usual time, 12:30, and over Zoom. Secondly, the congregation annual congregational meeting will be held on Monday, January 31st, over Zoom. And that meeting has all the usual pieces to it. One of the things I think would be helpful as I think about moderating that meeting, if you have questions that you'd like to have addressed by the session at that meeting that would be helpful to us to know in advance so we can give thought to that, please send them to me in an email. One of the things that I feel the effects of, and maybe you do, there's not much opportunity under these conditions of our worship to be, you know, chatting after worship and beforehand, and the exchange of information is not particularly dynamic. And I think you've got questions. I think, you know, those listening over Zoom have questions that we would like to address and be sure that meeting has all that it needs to have. So I offer that to you. Please help us in that regard. Sisters and brothers, this is our baptismal calling, to go out into the world and love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Holy, eternal majesty, holy incarnate word, holy abiding spirit, one God bless you now and forever.